Hello, welcome back to Kim Reads as we continue with Wicked. Will the action be completed by then? Who decides? I don't know yet, and I don't even know who decides, so don't ask me. Faye, suddenly he didn't like her code name anymore. Elphaba, do you really not know who's pulling the strings that make you move? How do you know you're not being manipulated by the wizard? You are a novice at this for all your status as a tribal prince, she said. Why shouldn't I know if I was being a pawn of the wizard? I could tell when I was being manipulated by that harridan, Madame Morrible. I learned something about prevarication and straight talking back at Crage Hall. Give me the credit for having spent some years at this, Fiyero. You can't tell me for sure who is or who isn't the boss. Papa didn't know the name of his unnamed god, she said, rising and rubbing oil on her stomach between her legs, but modestly turned her back to him. It is never the who, is it? It's always the why. How do you hear? How do you tell what to do? Look, you know I can't say. I know you can. She turned. Oil my breasts, will you? I'm not that stupidly male, Elphaba. Yes, you are, she laughed, but lovingly. Come on. It was daylight. The wind roared and even took the floorboards. The cold sky above the glass was a rare pinkish blue. She dropped her shyness like a nightgown, and in the liquid glare of sunlight on old board, she held up her hands. As in the terror of the upcoming skirmish, she had at last understood that she was beautiful in her way. The collapse of her reticence frightened him more than anything else. He took some coconut oil and warmed it between his palms and slid his hands like leathery velvet animals on her small responding breasts. The nipple stood, the color flushed. She was already fully dressed, but recklessly he pressed himself against her mildly resisting form. One hand slid down her back. She arched against him, moaning, but perhaps this time not from need. Still, his hand moved down onto her buttocks, felt between her cheeks and beyond. Felt the place one muscle pulled in crookedly, endearingly, felt the faintest etching of her hair being its crosshatch shadows. It swirled toward vortex. He worked his intelligence hand, reading the signs of her resistance. I have four companions, she said suddenly, retching away in emotion soft enough not to disengage but to discourage. Oh, heart, I have four comrades. They don't know who our cell leader is. It's all done in the dark, with a masking spell to shadow the voice and distort the features. If I knew more, the Gale Force would catch me and torture it out of me, don't you see? What is their object? He breathed, kissing her, loosing his trousers again, as if this were the first time, his tongue tracing the twisting funnel of her ear. Kill the wizard, she answered, looping her legs around him. I am not the arrowhead. I am the dart. I am the shaft, the quiver. She cupped more oil in her hands, and as they slid and fell in the light, she even made him bright and anguished with oil. She took deeper than ever before. Even after all this time, you could be an agent for the palace, she said later. I'm not, he said. I'm good. A little snow fell one week, and then some more the next. The feast of Lurleen must drew near. The Union's chapels having appropriated and transformed the most visible parts of the old pagan beliefs, hung themselves shamelessly in green and gold, set out the green candles and gold lawns and green berry wreaths and gilded fruit. Along Merchant Row, shops outdid themselves and the churches in decor with displays of fashionable clothes and useless and expensive trinkets. In display windows, papier-mâché figures evoked the good fairy queen Lorene in her winged chariot and her assistant, the minor fairy Prinello, who strewed gift-wrapped delights from her capacious magic basket. He asked himself again and again if he was in love with Elphaba. He also asked himself why he was so late coming to this question after 2 months of a passionate affair, as if he knew the words yet even meant, and if it mattered. He chose more gifts for the kids and for the sulky Sarima, that well-fed malcontent, that monster. He missed her a little. His feelings for Elphaba seemed not to vie those for Serena, but to complement them. No two women could be more alike. Elphaba demonstrated the proud independence of Arjaki mountain women that Serena, married so young, had never developed. And Elphie wasn't just a different, not to say novel, provincial type. She seemed an advance on the gender. She seemed a different species sometimes. He caught himself with a mammoth erection, just remembering the last time. And he had to hide himself behind some lady scarves in a shop until it subsided. He bought 3, 4, 6 scarves for Samira, who didn't wear scarves. He bought 6 scarves for Elphaba, who did. A shop girl, a dull munchkin-landed midget who had to stand on a chair to reach the till, said over his shoulder, "Just in a minute, ma'am." He turned to make room at the counter for the other customer. "But Master Fiyero," said Glinda. "Miss Glinda," he said flabbergasted. "What a surprise." "A dozen scarves," she said. "Look, Crow, look who's here." And there was Crow, a lowly jowly, though he couldn't be 25 yet, could he? Looked guiltily up from a display of feathery, plumy things. "We must have tea," said Glinda. "We must. Come now, pay for the nice little lady," and off we fly. In her voluminous skirt, she rustled like a corpse of ballerinas. He hadn't remembered her quite so giddy. Maybe this was married life. He slid a glance at Crope, who was rolling his eyes behind her neck. "Just you put this on Sir Chuffrey's account, and this," Linda said, mounting things on the counter, "and have them sent along to our rooms in the Florin Waith Club. I'll need them for dinings, so I'll have someone run over them right now, if you would. How dear, so kind. Ta-ta, boys, come along." She gripped Fiyero with a pinching hand and steered him away. Crope followed like a lapdog. The Florin Waith Club was only a street or two over, and they could have easily have carried the purchases back themselves. Glinda capered and clattered down the street, the grand staircase into the oak parlor, making enough noise so that every female resident looked up in a rewarding sort of disapproval. "Now you, Crope, there, so you can be mother and pour when we've ordered. And dear Fiyero, you're right here, right next to me. That is, if you're not too married." They ordered tea. Glinda got used to him a bit and began to calm down. "But really, who would have thought it?" she said, picking up a biscuit and putting it down again about 8 times in a row. "We were the great and good of the shiz. Really, look at you, Fiyero. You're a prince, aren't you? Do we call you your highness? I never could. And you're still married to the little child? She's grown up now and we have a family," Fiyero told her warily. 3 children. "And she's here? I must meet her. Now she's having back at our winter home, the Great Kells." "Then you're having an affair," said Glinda, "because you look so happy." "Who with? Anyone I know?" "I'm just so happy to see you," he said. And in fact, she was. She looked wonderful. She had filled out some. The wraith-like beauty had bloomed, but not coarsened. She was more woman than waif, and more wife than woman. Her hair was cut short in a boyish style, very becoming, and there was a tiara-like thing in her curls. "And now you're a sorceress." "Oh, hardly," she said. "Can I even get that damned serving girl to hurry up with scones and jam?" "I cannot. Yes, I can sign 100 greeting cards for the holiday season at one go. It's a very minor talent, I tell you. Sorcery is vastly overrated in the popular press. Otherwise, why wouldn't the wizard just magic the hell out of his adversaries? Now, I'm content to try to be a good partner for my Chuffrey. He's at the exchange today doing financial thingies. Oh, do you know who else is in the town? It's too rich, Crope. Tell him." Crope, surprised to give an opening, choked on his mouth full of tea. Linda rushed in. "Nessa Rose, can you believe it? She's at the family home here over on Lower Minipin Street, an address that's up quite a lot in the past decade, I might add. We saw her wear crepe. It was in the Coffee Emporium. It was the Ice Garden. No, I remember. It was the Spangletown Cabaret. Fiyero, do you know we went to see that Sillipede? Do you remember? No, you don't. I can see it in your face. She was a singer who was performing at Oz Festival of Song and Sentiment the day our glorious wizard arrived out of the sky in a balloon and orchestrated that coup. She's making yet another innumerable comeback tours. She's a bit camp now, so what? It was gales of fun, and there was a better table than we had. I might tell you, was Nessie. She was with her grandfather, or is it great-grandfather, the eminent Thra? He must be 1,100 years old by now. I was shocked to see her until I realized she went merely to provide him an escort. She didn't think much of the music. She scowled and prayed all through the entry act. And Nanny was there too. Who would imagine it, Fiyero? You're a prince. And Nessa Rose just about installed as the next eminent Thra. And Averick, of course, the Margrove of Ten Meadows, and a humble little me, married to Sir Chuffrey, holder of the most useless title and the biggest stock portfolio in Pertha Hills. Glinda almost stopped for a breath, but lunged in kindly. And Crope, of course, dear Crope. Crope, tell Fiyero all about yourself. He's dying to know. I can see it. Actually, Fiyero was interested, if only for the rest of him, from the staccato chatter. He's shy, Glinda pushed on. Shy, shy, shy. Always was. Fiyero and Crope exchanged glances and tried to keep their mouths from twitching. He's got this so on my guard little palace of a loft apartment on the top floor of a doctor's surgery. Can you imagine stunning views, the best views in the Emerald City at this time of year? He dabbles a bit in painting, don't you, dear? Painting a little musical opera set design here and here. When you were young, we thought of the world around all of you shiz. You know, there's a real theater right here now. The wizard has made this much more of a cosmopolitan city, don't you think? It's good to see you, Fiyero, said Crope. Say something about yourself before it's too late. You cad, you kid me mercilessly, sang Glinda. Well, tell me about your little affair with... Never mind. I'm not that mean. There's nothing to say, Fiyero said, feeling more taciturnum and vincus than he had when he first arrived at Shiz. I like my life. I lead my clan when they need it, which isn't often. My children are healthy. My wife is, well, I don't know, fertile, supplied Glinda. Yes, he grinned. She's fertile and I love her, and I'm not going to stay much longer as I'm meeting someone for a business conference across town. We must meet, said Glinda, suddenly plaintive, suddenly looking lonely. No, Fiyero, we're not old yet, but we're old enough to be old friends already, aren't we? Look, I've gushed on like a debutante who forgot to splash her eau d'amour. I'm sorry, it's just that wasn't a wonderful time, even if it's strangeness and sadness, and life isn't the same now. It's wonderful, but it isn't the same. I know, he said, but I don't think I can meet you again. There's so little time, and I have to go back to Kiamako. I've been away since late summer. Look, we're all here. Me and Chuffrey, Crope, Nessaros, you. Is Africa around? Could we get him? We could get together. We could have a quiet dinner party together in our rooms upstairs. I promise not to be so giddy. Please, Fiyero, please. Your Highness, it would do me such an honor. She cocked her head and put her single finger to her chin elegantly, and he could tell she was struggling through the language of her class to say something real. If I can, I'll let you know, but please, you mustn't count on it, he said. There will be other times. I'm not usually in town so late in the season. This is an anomaly. My children are waiting. Have you children, Glinda? Chuffrey is dry as two baked walnuts, said Glinda, making Crope choked on his tea again. Before you go, I can see you're getting ready to dash. Dear, dear Fiyero, what do you hear from Elphaba? But he was prepared for this, and he readied his face to be blank, and he only said, now that's a name I don't hear every day. Did she ever turn up? Surely Nessaros must have said. Nessaros says if her sister ever does turn up, she'll spit in her face, Glinda remarked. So we must pray that Nessaros never loses her face, for that would mean the evaporation of such tolerance and kindness. I think she would kill Elphaba. Nessaros was abandoned, rejected, left to look after her crazy father, her grandfather, Thingy, the brother, the house, the nurse, the staff, and you can't even single-handedly, she doesn't have any hands. And I'm going to stop there. Goodbye.